students, yesterday we have discussed the previously asked questions from the chapter Atoms and Nuclei. And first of all, there we have discussed the chapter Atoms and its theoretical questions and also some of the conceptual problems. So in that section, we have discussed already for hydrogen spectrum atomic models. And also we have discussed some of the factors about the X-ray spectrum. Means how can we get two types of X-ray spectrum, characteristics X-ray spectrum and continuous X-ray spectrum. So here, as we haven't discussed what will be the energy level diagram in case of characteristics X-ray spectrum. So let's discuss that first. After that, we will solve some of the conceptual problem and numerical problem today. So basically, as we know that X-rays produce whenever any accelerated electron is colliding with the electron in of inner core or electron in atom, and that time it just, if it is colliding or it incidents on that electron normally, that time it transfer whole of its energy to that electron, and easily that the core electron or any valence electron, whatever electron is there in the atom, that can remove from the particular orbit. So if any vacancy that is created inside the atom or in any core orbit, so that vacancy will make the atom unstable. So again, to attain the stability, the higher orbit electrons will make transition to the lower orbit, and in that way, obviously, when a higher orbit electron will make transition to lower orbit, then according to Bohr's third postulate, an electromagnetic radiation we will get, and that electromagnetic radiation is X-ray there. So this is the way in which we can produce characteristics spectrum if we arrange all the wavelengths that we are getting in that way in a particular order of wave, frequency or wavelength. Second condition is that if incidence of electron on any atomic orbit, orbital electron, that is oblique incidence, then in the case of oblique incidence, electron doesn't transfer whole of its energy, but still some of its kinetic energy is loses whenever it will collide with the inner core electron. So that loss in kinetic energy, and after losing its kinetic energy, it only changes its direction of movement. So in that way, the loss in kinetic energy that appears in form of electromagnetic energy. So there is also a conversion of energy here. Mechanical energy, kinetic energy is converting into the radiation, and in that way we can get the continuous range of wavelength or frequency, means continuous X-rays we can obtain here. So these are the two particular process to getting X-rays spectrum, and also we have two types of X-ray spectrum. So a continuous X-ray spectrum, I think only we have to understand how it will be produced, but for the characteristics X-ray spectrum, as its spectrum is analogous with the hydrogen spectrum, so we can see that how we will get that types of spectrum, and also will we get to the spectral series as we are getting in hydrogen, like Lyman series, Baumer series. So in which, in that same way we are getting here series or not. So for that case here, as we have talked about here, electron will knocked out from the inner cells here. So basically we just nominate cells as KL, MN cells and so on. We can, means electron, the inner core or inner cell is K cell, after that L cell, M cell and N cell. So suppose that this is nucleus, and outside the nucleus, number of, this is K cell, this is L cell, M cell and so on. So if any accelerating electron just knock out this any electron from this K cell, then definitely a vacancy will be created here. So it is against the Hund's rule that electrons should be filled up by in the increasing way of the energy. So it means that to make the stability of the atom, higher orbit electron will make transition here. So higher orbit electron can make transition from this L cell, M cell, N cell, O cell, means number of, from any of the higher cell electron can make transition here. So number of possibilities are here for the transitions. Suppose any electron that is making transition from L cell to K cell, or any electron that is making transition from M cell to K cell. So in this way, this obviously K cell will have some different energy, L will have different energy, M will have different energy, and we can calculate that energy with the help of Bohr postulate. Then in that case, if for different energies it has, then different frequency of radiation will emit from here, and obviously the different wavelength will be there. It means a series of wavelength we are getting in the same way as we were getting in case of hydrogen. If from higher states electron is making transition to n is equal to 1 state, then in that case we were getting Lyman series. So in the same way we are getting here, in higher orbit cells electrons are making transition to this K cell. So this series of wavelength that we are getting here, we call it K series. Second, electron can be knocked out from L cell also. As randomly accelerated electrons are colliding with the atom, then they can knock out any of the electron from any cell. So it means that whenever there will be vacancy created by that accelerating electron in L cell, then again higher orbit electron, if there is present there, then that will have tendency to fill up this vacancy first. So again, from M cell, electron will make transition. If there is N cell, then electron will make transition here. So in that way, again we are getting a series of frequency or wavelength. So this series is known as L series. So in the same way, if vacancy is created in M cell, we can get M series, N series, and so on. So if we have to draw the energy level diagram for this characteristic frequency or characteristics X-ray, means a particular X-ray we are getting or particular wavelength for the radiation we are getting here. So we can also draw it in this manner also, or as we are drawing the energy level diagram by straight lines. So we can take, this is K cell, this one is L cell, this is M cell, N cell, this is O cell, and so on. So when electron will make transition from L to K, M to K, N to K, so on, in that case the series of wavelength that we are getting, that is known as K series. So first series in characteristics spectrum we are getting, that is K series, whenever electron will make transition from higher state to K, this K cell. Second, if electrons are making transition from higher state to L cell, then that case we will get here L series. If it will make transition to M state, then we will get M series. If it is making transition to this, then N series we will get, and so on. So simple, in the same manner like we were getting the spectral series in hydrogen, we can get the series of a spectrum in X-rays also. So basically the theoretical problem that about the atoms chapter we have discussed, and here number of questions are asked. Basically one important question that I have discussed before in wave optics, also dual nature of radiation and matter also, but still here once again I just want to remind that questions to you, as 5 times this question is asked in your examination in different ways. So every alternate year it is asked. The question is that first question that we have discussed there, by using de Broglie assumption, prove the Bohr second postulate. And here this question is asked from this chapter, that is using Bohr second postulate of quantization of atom, prove the de Broglie hypothesis. Simple, if we have to use here Bohr second postulate of quantization of atoms or quantization of electrons in any atom, so that is any electron that has mass m that is moving with velocity v in any circular orbit of radius r, so obviously that will have the angular momentum mvr. So this is integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. Simple, this condition is applicable for the stationary orbit, means first postulate was there, electron will revolve only in certain circular orbits, and that certain circular orbits are known as stationary orbit, and electron will revolve only in those orbits for which its angular momentum is integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. So we have to use this condition to prove the de Broglie hypothesis. So to prove the de Broglie hypothesis, let's just write this equation in the terms. Let's multiply 2 pi here and let's move mv here. So we will get 2 pi r, this is equal to nh upon mv. And here we can see that this 2 pi r is the distance, and we are seeing that this is n times h upon mv, and that is de Broglie wavelength. So this is n lambda is equal to 2 pi r. So this is the assumption of de Broglie, that if any electron or any matter particle that is in motion, then there is a wave associated with it. And obviously, if that wave will move, then some of the wavelength it will produce. So we can see that if electron is started to make a movement as in the form of wave, then one wave is completed here, means one wavelength will be here. Again, it will move on this orbit in this way. And we will get a number of waves that will be constituted here. So obviously, if an electron will again reach this position, then the distance it will be completed, that is equal to 2 pi r, if there is the radius of the orbit is r. But we can also see this distance in terms of lambda. Lambda is distance of when wave completes one complete rotation. So here, if this wave is completed n rotation during this 2 pi r distance, or on moving on this circumference of the circular orbit, then total distance in one complete rotation, that will be equal to n lambda. So from here we can see that using de Broglie concept of wave motion of the matter particle, we can get this concept, and we can prove it by using Bohr concept of quantization. So we have just discussed that question before also. And here it's next problem is related to Thomson and Rutherford model. Some of the questions are here, and this is in the forms of fill in the blanks, and we have given two or four alternatives. So we have to just fill that alternatives in the suitable place. So a first question we have: the size of the atom in Thomson model is, after that there is a gap, the atomic size in Rutherford model. So we have to just give the fill the values, and here alternative is given much greater than, no difference, no different from, and much less than. Means overall the question is that the size of the atom in Thomson model is greater, less or same the atomic size in Rutherford model. So its answer is very simple. As Thomson gave first model that, and he assumed atom as the spherical shape, so the dimension he has given, Rutherford used the same dimension for his model. So there is no change in the atomic size in Thomson model and Rutherford model. So second alternative will be correct here, that size of the atom in Thomson model and Rutherford model is the same. Second question we have: in the ground state of gapping is here, electrons in stable equilibrium, while in again gapping electrons always experience a net force. And two alternatives we have, that is Thomson model and Rutherford model. So first question is that, or in another way I ask this question: in which model the ground state of electrons are in stable state, and in which model the ground state electrons always experience a net force? So obviously when we will talk about the Thomson model, then in that model electrons are distributed uniformly over the whole atom atomic sphere. So it means that if a whole of the charges are distributed symmetrically, then no net force they will feel inside the atom. So they will be always in a stable equilibrium. So first answer is that Thomson model in Thomson model, electrons will not feel any kind of net force, they will be in stable equilibrium. But in case of Rutherford model, as he has given the concept of nucleus, that in the nucleus there is positive charge that is situated and electrons are revolving round the nucleus, it means that if electron these are not uniformly distributed, these positive negative charges, then there will be the presence of Coulomb attraction between these positive and negative charges. So a net force will be present here in the case of Rutherford model, but it will not be present in the case of Thomson model. Third question here. An atom has a nearly continuous mass distribution in which of the model? So as again we have two model, Thomson model and Rutherford model, we have to just give answers that in which model the atom has a nearly continuous mass distribution. So continuous mass distribution means the atomic mass is present everywhere in the system. So we know that protons are responsible for the most of the masses of the atom, as electrons are very light particle. Protons mass is nearly 10 power 4 times to the mass of electron. So most of the mass of atom, you can just say that they are made up of the proton. So in the case of Thomson model, as positive charges, they are distributed uniformly throughout the whole of the space of atom, then in that case obviously there will be a continuous mass distribution. Second case is that in which model there will be a highly non-uniform mass distribution. So as in the case of Rutherford model, we have seen the concept of again nucleus and outside electrons are moving. So and also we know that the nuclear dimension is very small, means most of the mass of the new atom is concentrated in a tiny space, small space, and very small masses are distributed over the all the space of the atom, means there is non-uniform mass distributions. We have no uniform mass distribution. So simple non-uniform mass distribution will be in Rutherford model. Here if you are confused why I am not taking the Bohr model, so a Bohr model is only the correction in the Rutherford model, then definitely these all things are related to Bohr model also. So basic classical model that we have, Thomson model and Rutherford model, that's are we are just taking the differences in that two models here. Next question from the model we have, the positively charged part of the atom possesses most of the mass of the atom in which model? So again, just we have discussed in the case of Rutherford model, the most of the mass or positively charged masses is considered to be concentrated in this tiny space, that is nucleus. So this is the basic concept of Rutherford model, not of Thomson model. So five at least questions we have, one more questions. Next one conceptual question we have from the alpha scattering experiment. So as Rutherford model is based on the alpha scattering experiment, and also this experiment is very important for case study based problems. So question is that if you are given a chance to repeat the alpha scattering experiment using a thin sheet of solid hydrogen in place of a gold foil, so what results do you expect? So question is that as in the case of alpha scattering experiment we are using gold foil, then if we will use their solid hydrogen, then will we get the same result as we have got for the that case of alpha scattering experiment or not? And if we will not get that, then why? What is the reason we have to actually tell that? So as we know that hydrogen is lighter particle, and alpha particles or nuclei, you can say that alpha particles are 4 times massive than the nuclei of hydrogen. So it means that if mass of the alpha particle is greater than the hydrogen, then obviously its kinetic energy will be greater than the hydrogen also. So they will automatically cross the foil of solid hydrogen, means no interaction they will show with the solid hydrogen. So if there will be no interaction, then we cannot understand the concept of nucleus, we cannot understand the concept of electron there. Means we will feel that most all of the space in the atom that is free to move for the alpha particle. So that's why always whenever the particle we are choosing for any kind of bombardment, then there we need to know which of the particle will interact with the atom and which of the particle will not interact with it. Next question, that is, what is the shortest wavelength present in the Pashian series of spectral line? So as yesterday when we were discussing the theoretical problem, then there I have just told you how can we calculate it. So here a particular problem we have, what is the value of shortest wavelength in the case of Pashian series. So first of all, in the wavelength in case of hydrogen spectrum, we can get that by the formula, that is 1 by lambda is equal to R 1 upon N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. And in the case of Pashian series, this N1 is fixed, that is equal to 3 we have. And as I told you already, if any electron that is making transition from infinite to this state N is equal to 3, then that time we will get maximum energy, maximum frequency, then automatically we will get minimum wavelength. So here we have to calculate minimum wavelength. So obviously N2 will be equal to infinite here. So if we will put the values here, then we will get 1 by lambda, this is equal to R by 9, its value will be 0, this will be 9, or the value of lambda, this is equal to 9 by R, and if we will put the value of Rydberg constant, that is 1.097 into 10 to the power 7, then we can calculate what will be the shortest wavelength. So this is obtained 8204.1 angstrom. Next question is here. A hydrogen atom initially in the ground level absorbs a photon which excites it to the n is equal to 4 level. So determine wavelength and frequency of photon. So as question is simple here, any electron that is in n is equal to 1 state, or you can say that if we are talking about ground state, normal state, then we are talking the most least state that is possible in the atom, then obviously the value of n that is possible, the minimum value is 1. Means ground state will be n is equal to 1. So if any electron that is in n is equal to 1 and it absorbs any photon and it goes to n is equal to 4 state, then we have to give the value of frequency and wavelength for that particular photon that it has been absorbed. So here are two ways to calculate this problem as hydrogen atom is given. So first problem is that, like I just written the value of 1 by lambda is equal to R 1 by N square minus 1 by N2 square. Then in that way you can also calculate wavelength, and after that we can calculate easily frequency by using the value, that is nu is equal to C by lambda. In second way, we can calculate it. As we know that energy of the any particular orbit or level that is given by 13.6 by n square. This is particular value for hydrogen atom only, and here also hydrogen atom case is given, that's why directly you can use that formula. So if we have to calculate here the value of this energy n E1, so this is equal to n is equal to 1, this is 13.6 electron volt, and here n is equal to 4 state we have, so E4 will be equal to minus 13.6 upon 4 square. So we can find out its value. This will be also equal to 0.5 electron volt. So these two values now we have, and again If this E delta E, if we will calculate, then according to Bohr's third postulate, we know that the energy that is radiated or absorbed to excite any electron or whenever we are getting any emission of radiation, then that time it is given by the difference between any two energy state. And here the difference between two energy states, we have E4 minus E1, that will be equal to h nu. So from here we can calculate the value of mu by just separating these two energies here that we have calculated already. So after putting its value and after calculation, the value of frequency we will get, that is delta E by h, or in another way we can write E4 minus E1 upon h. So this will be equal to 3.078 into 10 to the power 15 hertz. And again, as we have calculated the frequency, then we can calculate wavelength by using the formula nu lambda is equal to c by nu. So if we will put all the values, then we can get 974.4 angstrom. Next question, one question we have. A 12.75 electron volt electron beam is used to bombard gaseous hydrogen at room temperature. So what series of wavelength will be emitted? We have to show that series of wavelength by using energy level diagram here. So first the question is given, if any electron that is at room temperature, it means that at room temperature normally all the atoms, all the electrons are in ground state. So if any electron that is at n is equal to 1 state, then if it absorbs a photon of energy 12.75 electron volt, it is given, then it will go into the sum of the excited state obviously. So suppose it is going in any nth state, then we have to find or we have to draw then energy level diagram whenever this electron, excited electron, will make transition again to this ground state. So obviously in this case, first we can calculate what will be the energy at this state and at this state. So at this state, n is equal to 1. As the case of again of hydrogen, we can just find out its energy by using the formula this. So at E1, this will be equal to again minus 13.6 electron volt. And if we will add this energy in this, then this will provide us the energy of this nth orbit. So energy of the nth orbit, this will be equal to minus 13.6 plus 12.75, and it is obtained to 0.85 electron volt. And again, if we will just use this formula, we can calculate what will be the value of n here. Means this is equal to minus of 0.85, and if we will solve it, the value of n is obtained 4. It means that if any electron in the ground state will absorb this energy, then this will go into the state n is equal to 4. Again, now if electron is n is equal to 4 state, then it will make transition from this state to this state. So let's see how many transitions are possible here and how can we draw the energy level diagram. So if n is equal to 4 levels, this is n equal to 3, n is equal to 2, and n is equal to 1 level we have, 1, 2, 3 and 4. And electron can make transition from 4 to 3, it is obviously free to move at any of the orbit, 4 to 2, 4 to 1. Again, if any electron is here in 3 state, it can make transition to 2 state, it can make transition to 1 state. Any electron is n at n equal to 2, it can make transition to 1. Ultimately, electron has to come in this state n is equal to 1, and for this it can adopt many of the methods, and if we will just represent all the methods here, that will provide you the required energy level diagram. So here 6 spectral lines we are getting for this particular excitation of the electron from the ground state. So particularly number of numerical problems we have discussed today, friends. So next rest of the numerical problem let's discuss in next class, and also after that we will discuss the chapter nuclei and its numerical problems. So for today, let's end the class here. Let's discuss the rest of the things in next class. Thank you.